now learning about more new details in the Reedley homicide. I'll have the latest tonight at 8.
Governor Gavin Newsom has set a date for the 2024 primary and special elections to fill the remainder of Representative Kevin McCarthy's term. I'm Emma Ott with all those details and more tonight at 8.
Also tonight, the Clovis Fire Department is highlighting this new piece of equipment to help people suffering from cardiac arrest. Your news in primetime is next.
New, local, unique. MyTV53 News at 8 starts right now.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to the San Joaquin Valley's only 8 p.m. news. I'm Austin Reed. It is Tuesday, January the 9th, 2024. Thank you for being here. We start with developing news as the Reedley Police Department discovered yet another body in a triple homicide investigation from the weekend. But this time, authorities have found someone else dead in the garage of a home directly next door to where the first three bodies were discovered. Reporter Louis Vail is following the latest developments and joins us from the newsroom with more.
That's right, a multi-agency helped out the Reedley Police Department after what they discovered is yet to be a fourth body.
At this time, what I'm releasing and what I'm going to be putting out to the community or to the press is that the safe was open and that the safe was what we believe to have contained various firearms was empty. No, that the two initial bodies that we found, the two initial victims that we found, were found underneath the tarp. The third body was not underneath that tarp.
The Reedley Police Department has made significant progress in the homicide investigation related to the events in the 100,000 block of South Church Avenue. In an effort to gather more evidence and information, the department has authored and served three search warrants in the cities of Selma, Parlier, and Reedley. In Selma and Parlier, at approximately 2:30 a.m., the Fresno County Sheriff's Office SWAT team successfully served the warrants. As a result, vehicles that may be connected to the homicide investigation were seized at both locations. Simultaneously, in Reedley, the search warrant was served by the Clovis Police Department SWAT team. During this operation, three individuals were detained, a female adult, a male adult, and a male juvenile. These individuals are currently being held at the Reedley Police Department pending interviews by investigators. A deceased person was discovered in one of the structures on the property. The deceased is described as a white male adult appearing to be in his 40s. There is no identification per pending on the next of kin. The death of these four individuals is not directly linked at this time, but the evidence collected may provide vulnerable insight into the circumstances. Various items potentially linked to the homicide investigation were found during the search of the Reedley residence. The case is evolving rapidly and the officers and investigators are working diligently to piece together the events that led to these tragic deaths.
It's continuing our investigation. I think that's the part that we're wanting to do is continue to follow up on leads that we have been provided, some through our anonymous tip line, some that have come directly to our investigators through interviews.
And there's no word yet if the detainees are associated with this crime. Reporting from ITV 53 News at 8, I'm Louis Vail.
Okay, Louis. Well, this just in from the Madera County Sheriff's Office on Friday morning of last week. The office received a 911 call from a home in the 15,000 block of Monreal Road in Madera County. The caller reported that an unknown individual was breaking into the home through the back door and had entered the house. When deputies arrived, they found a male occupant of the home had been in a physical struggle with the unidentified intruder. The intruder was unresponsive when deputies arrived at the scene, and despite efforts to revive him, he was pronounced deceased. The initial investigation indicates that the male homeowner confronted the individual as he was forcibly entering the home, and a physical struggle ensued. At some point during the struggle, the intruder lost consciousness. The investigation remains ongoing, and an autopsy will be scheduled to determine the exact cause of death. At this time, no arrests have been made. Well, California Senate Bill 2, which forbids lawful CCW permit holders from carrying guns in most public places, has once again been blocked from taking effect. Over the weekend, the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals ruled against last week's decision to allow the law to temporarily go into effect in 2024. The bill, signed by Governor Newsom last September, would have banned CCW permit holders in California from carrying guns in 26 types of public places, such as parks, sports stadiums, hospitals, and churches. New tonight and turning to election season 2024, we are learning more about the special election set to replace Kevin McCarthy. MyTV53's Emma Ott spoke with one candidate about this and brings us more from the news center.
On Monday, Governor Gavin Newsom set the date for the primary and special elections to fill former House Speaker Kevin McCarthy's seat after he resigned from Congress last month. Newsom set a March 19th primary and a May 21st election to fill the vacancy for the state's 20th congressional district. Meanwhile, the election to win McCarthy's seat is already underway. Several state and local GOP officials, including Assemblymember Vince Fong, former congressional candidate David Giglio, and Tulare County Sheriff Mike Boudreau, are already vying for the seat. America First candidate David Giglio says his loyalties lie with the people of the Central Valley.
You know, I'm the only one in this race who actually stood up and entered the race to challenge Speaker McCarthy because I believe that he hasn't delivered on his promises for the last decade. And when I say I don't owe anyone anything, I'm talking about big money, special interests, you know, large kind of corporate donors, special PAC money, and even Speaker McCarthy's former donors. You know, those people aren't funding me.
If you remember last month, it was a teetering decision whether candidate Vince Fong was going to be able to run for the seat. Secretary of State Shirley Weber previously announced Fong would be removed from the ballot because it violates state election law, which prohibits a candidate from running for more than one race at the same time, as Fong had already filed for re-election in the state assembly. To which Fong's campaign said they will sue for the right to run for Congress in the Sacramento County Superior Court. On December 28, 2023, Secretary of State then announced to appeal the ruling from a Sacramento Superior Court judge that would allow Vince Fong to enter the congressional race after all. Weber released a statement about the decision of the case, and here it is. Quote, I strongly disagree with the outcome of the case, and I am gravely concerned about the consequences of today's ruling. I do agree, however, with the court's expressed concern that the ruling may result in voter confusion and the disenfranchisement of voters if Fong is ultimately elected for both offices but does not retain one. End quote. And Weber isn't the only one who's unhappy about the outcome of the case.
I don't believe in kicking people off the ballot for non-legal reasons, but if you're going to break the rules to get on the ballot, that's a whole different story. And that's what's going on here. As Republicans, we've spent a lot of time over the last 3 years criticizing Democrats for trying to circumnavigate election laws during the 2020 election. And here you have a sitting Republican assemblyman backed by the former Republican Speaker of the House doing just the same thing.
The race is officially underway. The district is 46% Republican, 27% Democratic, and 18% no party preference. I'm Emma Ott, keeping you updated with MyTV53 News at 8.
Do stay with MyTV53 News at 8 for continuing coverage of election season. Other news on this Tuesday, Fresno County is now seeking an experienced professional for the position of homelessness program manager. The manager will be tasked with planning, organizing, and implementing regional homelessness initiatives, programs, services, and policies.
Hi, I'm Amina Flores-Becker, Deputy CAO with the County of Fresno, and I'm here to highlight a wonderful career opportunity of the Homelessness Program Manager. This position will work closely with stakeholders throughout the region to collaborate and coordinate the county's response to homelessness.
Recruitment closes January 12th at 4 p.m. You can apply online right now. We are back in storm mode tonight. A major storm is hitting the East Coast right now. New at 8, reporter Gavin Martin is tracking the activity.
From Florida to New York, the East Coast is either digging out from a blizzard or cleaning up from a storm after a massive storm system brought chaos, knocking out and making driving conditions terrible. One man literally got a ruler and measured the snow in his backyard in Kansas. And in Raleigh, North Carolina, a video taken from a person's home shows hurricane-like winds, making it impossible for people to drive. Also, in another part of North Carolina, a person in Catawba County died in a mobile home due to the storms. The system is moving out. However, there's another system right behind it. However, it appears it won't be as bad as this one. I'm Gavin Martin, MyTV53 News at 8. Austin, back to you.
Gavin Martin on the story, thank you. Here in Central California, another cold system will impact the region Wednesday morning through Thursday morning, resulting in low elevation snow across the Sierra Nevada and adjacent foothills. The snow level will start out at around 3,000 feet Wednesday before dropping to about 2,000 feet Thursday morning. Our partners at Stuhlwell News captured the scenes in the South Valley today where frost was on homes and plants and vehicles, showcased exhaust vapors as temperatures in many locations were actually below freezing earlier. As for the majority of this next precipitation, it will fall Wednesday night. We'll have your full forecast coming up later in this newscast. And that does it for your first few minutes of nonstop news today, but don't go anywhere. We are just getting started. Still ahead.
Fresno State basketball is in conference play and the college football playoffs have crowned the champion. I'm Valentina Saldana with that story coming up.
But next, the city of Tehachapi is offering reminders to winterize your vehicle as snow fell there overnight. Plus, we have a brand new We Work For You series from the city of Fresno. This evening, we are highlighting an employee from Fax Transit. You're watching the news today. New, local, unique. We're back in a little over 2 minutes.
This is MyTV53 News. New, local, unique with Austin Reed. You're watching MyTV53 News at 8.
All right, welcome back on this Tuesday, turning to our big stories in Kern County for our viewers watching on KNXT 53. The greater Tehachapi area saw trace amounts of snow overnight and will be facing frigid temperatures for the rest of the week. So here is your reminder to winterize your vehicle ahead of time.
In addition to the winter preparation for the public works, we do ask that the public, homeowners, businesses alike, you guys take a little preparation for yourself. One of those things is to make sure your car is up to speed. It's good to go. Your wipers are good. Your tires are good. And if you do any traveling, you know, east or west to Bakersfield or the Antelope Valley, make sure your car is full of gas one way or the other. In addition to that, make sure you have a bag in your car. If you've ever been stuck in the freeway, food, water, a blanket, you could be sleeping in your car overnight if that freeway gets shut down due to an accident or snow or ice issues.
Helpful reminders for sure. Hey, new tonight from the city of Bakersfield, the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Community Center on South Owen Street will be hosting a free community luncheon and clothing giveaway next Monday, January 15th. Clothes are currently being collected by the Recreation and Parks Department, AmeriCorps, and the MLK Breakfast Committee. Anyone interested can drop off their donations right now at the MLK Community Center or call 661-322-9874. Back in Fresno, we have a brand new We Work For You series from the city. With Fresno Fax Buses providing millions of rides each and every year, things are bound to get lost and left behind by riders. So where do they go? They end up at the Fax Lost and Found lot. That's where Maria Alvarez works hard to reunite lost belongings with their owners. Here's more.
After they get their items back, they're very thankful. They like to thank the bus drivers or whoever turns them in. So my name is Maria Alvarez, and I'm an administrative clerk too. Not a lot of people know that we have the lost and found. All the items from the buses get brought to me. They come and bring me all the items that were left on the bus from the previous day. I do another check. Anything that's disposable, like perishables, they have to be thrown out. I enter all that in the database. A lot of like cell phones, wallets, bags, bikes, some kind of strange like vacuum cleaners, printers, a bale of hay, a lot of different things. Weird things come in. So it's like a surprise every day. We hold it for about 3 months. After that, we donate it. Bikes get donated to a church, so they refurnish them and give them to children who need them or people who are in need of them. Phones, if they're really good still, they get donated. Same thing with clothing. Every day we get people coming in asking for their things. If we do have them, they will have to be just very descriptive of it. If they have pictures or proof of it. One person, she had lost, I think, everything in a fire, and the last thing she had was her phone.
Well, if you have lost a belonging on a fax bus, you can call 559-621-RIDE, provide a detailed description of your item, and Maria and the team will see if they have it.
MyTV53 News continues with the Valley's local forecast.
The Clovis Fire Department is highlighting a new piece of equipment that will significantly enhance the quality of service they provide to those who suffer from a cardiac arrest. Yeah, so with the support of the Assistance to Firefighters Grants Program, Clovis Fire was able to purchase a Lucas chest compression system for each of their first out apparatus. Traditionally, when a patient is in cardiac arrest, manual chest compressions are provided by a firefighter on scene. After long periods of time, personnel can fatigue, which can reduce the effectiveness of chest compressions. Now, with this device, chest compressions are perfect, consistent, and uninterrupted throughout the entirety of the incident. All right, it is time now for sports shorts. Here's our Valentina Saldana.
Fresno State men's and women's basketball have wrapped up their preseason and are now in Mountain West Conference play.
Hill working his way left around that to Ducell in the corner, catch and shoot triple for the tie.
The men's basketball team has had a rough start in conference play, going 0-2, with their first conference game against San Diego State ending in a 74-47 loss. That was followed by another 72-57 loss against Nevada on Saturday night. The women's basketball team are three games into conference play, holding a 2-1 record. They opened up with a 59-49 win against Air Force, then a 70-67 win against San Jose State. On Sunday, the Bulldogs did fall short 7 points against the San Diego State Aztecs for their lone loss. Although it is still early on in conference play, in the Mountain West standings, the men's basketball team sits at a four-way tie for last place, while the women's basketball team is tied at second with San Diego State. The women's team is back at the Save Mart Center tomorrow night at 6 p.m. to take on the Colorado State Rams. The men's team will travel to Laramie and play against Wyoming Cowboys on Saturday. The FBS championship took place yesterday night and the Michigan Wolverines came out on top 34-13 against the Washington Huskies. The win completes Michigan's perfect season at 15-0. From the start of the game, Michigan took the lead and never gave it back with a 41-yard rush touchdown by Donovan Edwards and a kick by James Turner. Washington scored a field goal after, but Michigan struck back with two scoring drives in a row, making the score 17-3. Fresno native Jalen McMillan scored for the Huskies during the second quarter, cutting their deficit by 7 points. But Michigan kept its momentum going into the second half and only allowed one field goal from the Huskies for the rest of the game. Head coach Jim Harbaugh claimed a national title for his alma mater for the first time since 1997. Fresno State will actually play the reigning national champions for their season opener on August 31st.
That is all for Sports Shorts. I'm Valentina Saldana. Austin, back to you.
Valentina, thank you. Next at 8, commercial growers in the Central Valley are now using these large fans to protect citrus trees. We'll tell you the main reason behind that next in Prime Time. Before we say goodnight, our partners at Stuhlwell News caught the sights of agriculture farms all around the Selma and Kingsburg area this morning. Here's a fun fact, though. Commercial growers are now using these large fans and wind machines to protect citrus trees from severe frost caused by temperature inversions. The fans mix the layers of warm and cold air, raising the temperature at the surface. Frost exposure for as little as 30 minutes can cause significant damage, leaving fruit unmarketable. This is especially true for some of the less cold, hardy varieties. Let's get one final look at your forecast. A quick reminder, we have that winter weather advisory going into effect for the mountain locations. That will stay with us through Thursday. Here in the valleys, we're looking at sunny conditions, but still very, very cold. It definitely feels like January. And that's going to do it for your news on this Tuesday. I'm Austin Reed, hoping your news is good news. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you back here tomorrow.
Austin Reed, weeknights at 8 on MyTV53 News. New, local, unique.